There it goes. Okay. Now we are recording. So welcome everyone again. Marco's consultant talks. We're kind of really dedicated to just inviting and bringing all the different consultants. I'm going to select everyone, have all of you muted for the moment. That way we're kind of all on the same page. Here's what we'll do. We're going to go through, do quick introductions. If you guys want to join in, please use the chat window. If you have the chat window up and you have something you want to talk about or question or anything, I'll ask those questions or Daniel will ask the questions or we can unmute you and have a discussion. It doesn't really take us off track as long as we're kind of in the same ballpark. Whatever we want to discuss in this group of consultants is fair game. So we'll get started by doing that. So first off, my name is Charles Duncan. I am the National Consultant Liaison. I've been doing this for Barco for almost 8 years now. Recently, we brought in Damon Levesi. Damon's here to help out. We put him in the Eastern time zone. So, Damon, just a little bit about yourself. Let you do a quick intro, and we'll get rolling.
Yeah, so I've been at Barco about 8 months. Came by way as a pre-sales engineer over at Crush on an end user before that. And so that's where my background comes from. But, you know, we're getting a lot of traction, just trying to get in front of people as much as possible in the Northeast, which is, you know, hard. So do as much virtual stuff as possible. Then when everybody's ready to get out, you know, we have places to go and things to show you.
Yeah, we definitely have places to go. Well, here with us today is we brought in Dak Patrick. Dak heads up our sales engineering group. He's actually the authority on our control room. We're going to lean on him a little bit today. And I also brought in Mike Benson. This is a VP of our control rooms division as well. So two authorities in this particular category are going to give us a good little bit of information. So let's get going. Today's scope is really just talking about the complete control room. And if you really look at the control room itself, we have to break it down and really in the four quadrants. Those four quadrants are basically the large video wall, wall for collaboration, war rooms, conference rooms, breakout rooms and such. And then you start looking at remote users that may be in the field and how they bring information, how we share information in and out. And then, of course, operator positions, KVM locations. We know them as op space locations. We're going to talk a little bit about that. And then, of course, the management software that really runs everything. So, Dak, we're going to start off heading your direction. Let's just take a simple question. What is CMS? So what is that control management software? And I'm going to let you just take the ball and run with it here.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for the invite. Guys, my name is Dak Patrick. I'm director of sales engineering for North America for our enterprise market. My little history here is I worked in control rooms in the military for many, many years, and just so happened to one day be an engineer within the realm. Subject matter expert, feel free to reach out to me anytime. I imagine you'll have my contact info inevitably via email. So great question with the four quadrants. So Barco is kind of, unfortunately, Charles, I can't share my screen. I don't know if I have the rights to do that. I just don't know.
I'll pass it to you.
Okay.
I'll pass it to you so you can share that.
Good deal.
There you go.
In my showroom, which is a lovely showroom at that, here in Atlanta, Georgia. But I did want to go over again a little bit about our four quadrants. So Barco's been in the control room industry for many, many years. We came up with the first rear projection video wall back in the early 90s. And as years ticked on and the product has grown, we have great software that complements specifically our video wall technologies. So as you look at these four quadrants, we'll start with the bottom left. That's your typical large video wall users sit in front of for quick decision making and collaboration. To the right, the bottom right quadrant, that's going to be your breakout room, meeting room, war room, whatever your industry might call it. It's just a simplistic meeting room, executive conference room. The content you see in the control room on the large video wall, since Barco makes it IP-based, we can send that content right down the hall to another conference room. But what's really cool is that same content can also be shared to multiple conference rooms at one time, multiple control rooms. And what are those control rooms are in the same building, the same campus, the same state, same continent or intercontinental, we can share the content as well to other locations and we can actually federate your control rooms. Top left quadrant, we have something called op space or operator workspace, which is going to be your KVM solution. So, you know, you can still work, it still works with a video wall, but sometimes people don't need a video wall. They just want a really, they want a great location here at the console where users can interact with remote sources. But remember, with Barco, any source, anywhere. So the same content on your video wall, same content in the conference room, can also be the same interactable content right at your desktop console. But what about when the supervisor's out at lunch, he's in line to get food, and there's an emergency? Or maybe you have someone out in the field, a utility worker, and he sees something is broken or blown out in the field in the middle of nowhere. How can he get video data from his phone back to the control room? And how can information from the control room get out to him or to that boss that's out there trying to get lunch? We have something called Secure Stream. So the same content inside the control room, same content sitting at the console for op space, can easily be shared encrypted over the cloud to thousands of users at the same time with low latency. We call that Secure Stream. So we've kind of hit all four points: large video wall, conference rooms down the hall, your operator work console, and then what about someone not in the building, on the road? They can pull a website up from their phone, not know you need of an app, and have encrypted content directly to their phone. So that specifically has to do with the four quadrants. I'm going to go ahead and exit out of my screen share here. I kind of want to explain a little bit more about OpSpace or the CMS itself. So CMS simply means Control Room Management Suite. Basically, four components are with CMS. We have a centralized server, your application server, your unmanned displays, which Barco manufactures numerous unmanned displays. You have manned displays, which might be the one in front of you. And then we also have sources. Sources is really your content. So Barco uses the term source. Reality, the content here in my room, content on my video wall, that would be a source. CMS software application is suited and designed to be user-friendly. It's easy to learn environment. It supports efficient decision-making. It's extremely flexible and extremely scalable. You might have a video wall the size of the one behind me. If in a year or two, you want to add another column, not a big deal. You can add another column, or you can remove a column. If you need it to be smaller, maybe move those displays somewhere else. It's fully modular, network-based architecture. And it's easy to use video wall management, efficient collaboration, and fast decision making. Software provides operators and decision makers with easy video images and data and allows them to connect this information to configure and how and where it is displayed on the wall. The software provides operators and decision makers also the ability to collaborate in a very, very efficient way. Customers have invested also in the VMS-based solutions, let's say Milestone or Genetac, and you have a bunch of video cameras. We have a great third-party API, plugins made by both us and the VMS software maker, to where you can actually control our product right from their user interface with no need to manipulate the Barco client software in itself. Back to you there, Charles.
Okay. Well, that's a great info. It's kind of get a quick understanding of how the CMS software really works and operates and utilizes all the peripherals around there. And speaking of peripherals, let's talk a little bit about the display options. And maybe from the point of the customers, and Mike, feel free to join in. What are you guys seeing, or what are you seeing from the customers themselves? What type of displays? What I mean is you see more of the projection cubes, LED, LCD. What are we really seeing in our customers' requests these days?
You know, it was. It's,
go ahead, Dick.
Okay, yeah, it was. It's kind of been a growing thing, right? I think back in the day, it was definitely a projection based solution. Barco has started the rear projection cube industry. So RPC laser cube is where we're at now. Since our video wall displays, all of our displays that we manufacture are modular. With, you know, cube used to be lamp driven, and then it went to an LED driven. And now since Barco were the projector people, you know, now we have a laser projector with high efficiency and color contrast. Also, LCD market has grown as commercial displays have gotten cheaper. Barco has created a great way of narrowing the bezel. A lot of the world has heard about our Unicy product, which is still the world's only bezel-less display, which is what's sitting behind me. And then, of course, DirectView LED. So with DirectView LED, LCD, and rear projection cube, completely modular systems. You have separate display, you have separate glass, you have separate LED boards, you have separate input boards, you have separate power supplies. So any individual part can be easily swapped out in minutes. As far as what we're seeing in the control room, we're pretty much seeing all of these. You don't really see too much projection anymore, but it's still an option. I was just at a huge utility out in Iowa, and they had projection in all of their rooms. So it's still integratable, and it's still a great solution. Now, what would you choose and opt to pick for what you're trying to do? I'll share a little picture here. So here's kind of like a, you don't have to use this as the actual template, but here's kind of an idea. 7 feet away, you know, I got a 0.63 millimeter LCD display like Barco Unicy. You know, I'm getting down to the 9 and 10 foot range. I'm going to go jump into the rear projection cube as an option. Mind you, this could be direct LED. We're just kind of giving you a nice little example. And then we're going to move to the pixel pitches the further away we get from the video wall. So one big thing about having Unicy or ODL is that you get a little bit more bang for your buck if you're really looking for resolution and pixel space. So if I'm going all the way to the back of 21 feet for a 0.9 millimeter video wall, you know, that's going to be a really big wall to achieve the same resolutions I might be able to get with an LCD display, mainly because of the pixel pitch itself.
So if I could just jump in here for a second. Thank you, Dak. I just wanted to say that it also kind of depends on, you know, what other requirements they have. For sure, you know, where they're sitting is going to be a big requirement, but things like budget come into play, how often they want to refresh their control rooms, how much space they have, what kind of content they're going to put on the wall. So for example, in the utility sector, they tend to look at these as 10-year purchases. They have purpose-built control rooms in most cases. So there's space for them to put in our rear projection cubes, and that's still kind of the display type of choice. In command and control, you know, they really don't like scenes. They have a lot of video. And so in particular in the military, they use a lot of LED. And then, you know, when budget's a big concern, you know, we've got a full range of these LCD products and with different size bezels on them. And so there's typically something that will fit in there. They don't take up a lot of room. And like Dak said, you know, because we can put video anywhere, sometimes maybe a backup area might just use a front projection as an inexpensive way to have a backup control area that they can go to or an overflow area, because we can very easily route content into these other locations. So all of those other considerations can kind of come into play when picking your display.
That, Mike, you kind of actually alluded to, you know, the next question is, you know, you guys have mentioned sharing to different spaces, boardrooms. Even Dak had mentioned, you know, going to remote users. So what are some examples of how we get that done? Because we have consultants on the line, right? They're not just doing, in some cases, yes, maybe they're just doing a control room, but most of our consultants are designing for the whole enterprise, right? So control room's one aspect of it. How do they utilize that to get to other spaces within the enterprise?
Yeah, great question. So since everything is IP based, once something is encoded, or just an IP stream, like let's say a VNC based client, we can take this content and just send it through a standard layer 3 network switch. Then that client can be shared, as you can see on my camera, it can be shared around the room, showed multiple times with packet efficiency known as multicast. And we can share that content just simply over IP over your standard network. You see, I have 3 video walls. There's my DirectView LED. This is my Unicy video wall, which is a 4x2. 2 4K signals, and then my 3x2 of rear projection cube. So any source, anywhere, content can be shared to the meeting rooms, control rooms, to include locations like across campus, state, country, or different continents. We call that federation. And then again, also that since it is IP-based and encoded, we can send it over our encrypted secure stream application to where it can be sent to a mobile device or someone on the go from their laptop.
Yeah, and Damon, too, this is something that Barco really pioneered. You know, we have a way to take all of these sources. We can encode them in a way that uses the right amount of bandwidth. That's always a big concern when you're talking about IP. In fact, we can use different amounts of bandwidth if you're going, like Dak said, if you're using multicast inside a facility versus going outside the facility. We have a lot of intellectual property around keeping the latency very, very low, which is critical to this. And even the way that we sort of build how the content gets to the display wall is very unique, because we have these nodes that can receive all these signals, and then we manage it with our control room software to get the content up on the wall. So it's receiving the IP data right to these nodes, and then we put it right directly from there up to the wall. So it makes us really unparalleled in being able to both scale up to very, very large sizes and also scale out to a lot of different locations and a lot of different display types.
We actually have a, that led right in, your answer, Mike, just led right into a question from one of our consultants, Wayne Chance, which we all know because he's been on panels.
Yeah, hey, Wayne.
His question is, what about multiple networks? Could I assign a stream to a specific secure channel? And I don't know if Charles, if you want to unmute Wayne, if he wants to get further into that with these. I don't know who the right person to answer, Mike or Dak. I'm sure either one of you did.
Yeah, I can answer that. So there's a few ways of doing this. We can mix networks, but Barco actually has a one up on the system. And I'm going to actually share my screen again here. Give me 1 second, and I'm going to share a PowerPoint drawing here. I want you to see that what we can do is, this is actually a customer that has multiple networks, right? So they have multiple networks that cannot talk to each other. So they might have a business network, network 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so these, what we're able to do is leave these computers on their segregated networks, not VLAN together, absolutely separate networks. We're able to capture keyboard, video, mouse, and audio through our encoding. What this does is a complete network isolated, a network, an air gap between the two networks. So these networks are not talking. Finally, when this content is sent into an encoder, we can then bring the content over through a network switch, which then we're on a isolated AV network, doesn't even see the internet. Our system doesn't care about the internet. We're not looking for internet connectivity. We can bring that into the system here, into a layer 3 switch, send that down to another switch or to the same switch, which then can be sent to the decoders, and your content can then be streamed from those PCs and placed on the wall wherever you see fit, and you're not stuck to the bezel. So in this scenario, for this design, we have 3 large decoders. These are, you can put 2 of these side by side in a server rack. They're actually not big, they're pretty small. You can put these side by side in a server rack, and these things can actually decode multiple streams. Just one box can drive up to 16 displays if you'd like. In this scenario, they're only driving 2, which gives me more maximized decoding power. And with this hardware, I can decode up to 12 HD signals just from encoding, and I can put 40 cameras on one of these as a decoding power. So they can decode a lot. If it's VNC, one of these boxes can decode more than 100 VNC connections onto one display. So very, very powerful in what they do for the decoding purposes.
And if I could just jump in real quick, I just wanted to say, because you were kind of talking about how you could do different layouts. For those on the East Coast, we do have a space on 3rd Avenue where we can show a small example of that. And so it's not a full control room setup, but you know, we could always make Dak do some extra work if we need to.
Yeah, we have some stuff there, but I did want to show you that, you know, these computers are on isolated networks by themselves, 4 different separate networks that cannot communicate between themselves. And then we just add in our encoding. We capture pixel space, keyboard, mouse, and audio, and then we bring that in through a layer 3 switch to be onto the AV or audio video network, or let's say a Barco network, to be viewed on the wall, as well as viewed at the user console if you were to choose our Talkspace KVM solution.
So Wayne, if you were getting at, so what Dak just described is the most common thing. That's one of the things our customers love, is that you can isolate the network, the Barco network, as Dak described, and bring in content then from multiple networks. But sometimes people want connected but separate networks. We can handle that too. We make use of standard, you know, IP networking tools like VLANs and gateways and things like that too. So we can kind of do all the standard stuff that you would do with data to bring content, you know, to and from disparate networks. So that's part of the answer too.
Okay, because there's outside of the military applications, there's also in conference, in some of the conference areas I'm seeing, they have a central control room that manages video conferencing. And it would be nice in this situation, then they would be able to send out video conferencing to a separate conference room. So that there is, outside of the military, there are applications for it. So I appreciate that.
All right. Before we jump to the next question, there was something Stephen brought up a little while back. But I think, Mike, you mentioned Federation. Could you restate what you might have meant by the Federation earlier. I was kind of backing up a little bit, but.
Sure. Yeah. Let me give the high level answer. And then Dak, if you want to drill into what the details are on that, but basically Federation means that two disparate locations can each have their own users, their own content, their own sources. And when you federate them, it makes all of that information available to the other site. Think about your directory in Outlook, how you can see users that are not in your physical building. Maybe they're not in your same department or your same division or whatever. That's because you're federating that information between those different locations. So we can do that with control rooms as well. So if you have a control room in New York and a control room in London, and you've got ample connectivity between them, even though they're on separate networks, we can make it so that sources and what we call, you know, perspectives and layouts, and using some of the jargon that's in the product, but different ways that you can put the sources together, we can make those available on different sides, and we can make users with certain permissions available on either side too, as a federation. And so it's really, really cool because it gives you this ability to kind of have round the clock monitoring of assets. If you've got, like I said, a location in New York and one in London, you've got a 6-hour time difference. So when, you know, one kind of shuts down, the other one can kind of take over. You can have backup. You can have access for executives. There's a lot of great things that you can do with Federation. And frankly, that's been really one of the biggest, most important things for our large corporate customers lately. We've got a number of them that have standardized on Barco control rooms because all of our content is using IP networks. And then when we federate it, it gives them that ability to share, like I said. So Dak, do you want to correct all the stuff I got a little bit off?
No, you nailed it. Yeah, okay. Pretty much we can take up to 6 control rooms and then integrate and share the content from each control room back and forth. In the app, in the sidebar application, which is the user end user client, you'll see those sources populate as they need to be shared. So every source is manageable to be shared back and forth, and then it auto generates within the sidebar application to be viewed.
And one thing I'd like to just jump in and say here too, before we're completely out of time, is that Dak, as he stated earlier, is obviously in our demo facility in our US headquarters in Atlanta. We've got demo facilities all over the place. But one of the things that he's done, because he's here, is he has completely outfitted this facility to be able to do remote demos. It's been just invaluable for us during this whole lockdown thing with COVID. So number one, if you guys ever have the ability to get to Atlanta, we would love to bring you in and let you actually see how gorgeous our displays are and how awesome our control room is. And you can learn this stuff a lot better that way. But also, if you have, you know, for your own learning, or you had customers that actually wanted to see this stuff, Dak can take you through this control room, all this control room technology virtually right there from where he's sitting, as he's been kind of showing you as he's moving his camera around. He can go into the software. He can bring content in and out of the control room. It's really, really a fabulous way to actually learn about the Barco control room solution. So I just wanted to get that little commercial in there because we're giving you guys a little bit of information today, but there's a lot of questions you might have down the road, and getting scheduling some time with Dak to kind of go through a control room tour would probably really be great for you.
Yeah, that is always a treat to spend some time with Dak.
There's no cats fighting underneath our control room either, so our demo room. Okay.
Well, you mentioned a couple of things, and in lieu of time, I want to combine some together. We've got about 5 or 6 minutes left in the dedicated time frame, but you know, I wanted to kind of jump into some of the applications and ask you to compare some of the different types of application, which may lead to Dak showing some different types of applications. But really, what I'm combining that with is where does Barco really innovate, and how do we really separate ourselves? And I guess in conjunction with these types of applications, I'll let you guys kind of run with it. It's kind of a generic open question, but we've got about 5 minutes left to discuss some of that.
Yeah, you know, in the control room market, Barco not only has the displays, but we also manufacture our hardware across the across the board. So whenever you implement a full Barco solution, you have one phone number to call. You're not calling a bunch of other companies to get things settled if a problem ensues. Also with our software suite, you know, we have a full-blown Linux deployment. We have a full-blown Windows-based deployment. So you get either or, depending on what you need. Barco believes completely in full redundancy. So we have full redundancy, not only on the server side application level, we also have redundancy at the video wall processor level. So if a column on one of my displays goes out, that system will immediately catch it and will fix the video wall by itself automatically in real time. Full integration for the KVM and remote user applications like SecureStream. We stand out by having the ability to complement isolated networks. In other words, creating an air gap network, leaving the corporate and secure networks completely isolated. Great for the federal space. We do a lot with the federal spaces, three-letter acronyms for them to be able to view their different different networks on the same screen or on the same video wall. Again, we manufacture our encoders, the software, the decoders, the video wall processor, the displays. So you have that one phone number to call. It's very flexible and catering to almost any design need. We can create that on the fly as necessary. We love feature requests as well. And one-stop shop for your control room need.
So, thank you, Dak. I'm going to answer that question a little differently too. You know, when I think of applications, I just think of all the different things that can be called a control room, right? We've got command and control for the military. We've got traffic management centers, network operations centers, security operations centers, or global security operations centers, process control, emergency operations, clinical command centers, campus or event security. And we're even seeing things like social command centers where a corporation wants to monitor what their footprint is out there in the social world. Very important to them. They also are monitoring things like potential threats onto their websites and stuff like that. And with COVID, I'm hearing about certain types of control rooms getting built up in the hospitals, but also for corporations and stuff to just kind of manage and control and view what's going on with how COVID is affecting them. So the definition of control rooms is really expanding. I've only been with the company for 4 years, and even just in my time, when I first started, the first control rooms I thought of were the big ones. You think about NASA, all the movies, there's always a big command center there. In the utilities where they've got, the single line SCADA stuff, all the lines and stuff going everywhere. But man, oh man, the control rooms can be just a couple of operators in a smaller area, just monitoring important information, collaborating on it. So the definition is really, really expanding these days.
All right, we had some great info and great answers. We could go on, I think, probably another half hour or so, but really we're right towards the end of this. I'd like to kind of open it up and ask if there's any other questions that our group of consultant friends that we have online. This is where I usually say, hey, heads up, I'm about to unmute everyone. So if you have something going on, just kind of be prepared. I'm going to unmute, and if you have any other questions, feel free to jump in. We've got about 2 minutes left here. I can find my mouse on my screen here.
We can always set one-on-one time with Dak and his team, and that's very easy to do to dig into any of this stuff deeper.
Okay. Yep.
All right, so I have unmuted everyone. If you guys have any other questions, feel free to jump in here. You're always welcome to use the chat window. But while you're thinking of those questions, I think we had some stuff we talked about. Is there other processing that we see in the space? Or, I think we already touched on some of the government security operations centers and such. But at the same time, Mike and Dak, if there's other little important pieces you want to throw in the last minute of our webinar here, go for it.
The question from Scott Brim in the chat. Did you guys see that? He's asking, are cities measuring ROI on command centers? And Scott, I'm going to say, not that I can state specifically, most of the time what cities are doing is sort of, the funding is always very convoluted. So measuring ROI is maybe difficult. So I'm sorry, I don't have a good answer on that. Dak, have you heard of any, you know, any cities that are actually measuring their ROI on the command centers specifically?
I have not. It might be something. Yeah,
that might be a good question for Mike Morbetto. Specifying for government clients.
Yeah, it could be, you know, like if we're talking about something in process control, you know, you can measure things like downtime and stuff like that. You can measure things like loss or hit to your image and stuff like that in more corporate cases. And in security, you know, you can measure things about, you know, both physical and network security and how that might be costing your business and how fast you can react to it and stuff. But for cities and emergency operations centers, it's just a little harder to do a hard ROI on that, Scott. But maybe there's a way to do it.
Yeah, and I know we're at the end of our time, but I did want to say, you know, one thing about the Barker Controller Management Suite, that it's all about viewing better, sharing faster, resolving quicker. And remember, it's based on a modular network-centric media distribution platform. So it can be put, your content is any source anywhere and be shown as needed, as necessary, at the touch of a finger, very quick.
Hey, Scott, on Zoom calls, Scott also asked, can Zoom calls be integrated as a source? And, you know, the answer is yes, but it's probably something you should give Dak a call and he can explain to you how we would do that.
Yes. All right, so as we close up here, Stephen, we got your message. We're going to make sure that we get somebody to get you a call back. I see you got some stuff you want to discuss with us. So we'll take care of that, jump on that. Damon, you mentioned Mike Morbetto last week. So heads up for everyone. Next week, next Friday morning, we're going to do a session that's specifically specifying for government clients. So Mike will be our expert on that topic. And, you know, these same type of questions may come up again, but specific to the government market. So, you guys don't have anything else. We're at that 30-minute window. It's been another great session. 30 minutes of just quick little bits of info. Of course, we're trying to make sure that we're not chewing up too much of the consultant's time. So my feedback I've gotten is 30-minute works great, but we're not taking up their whole day. And so we want to continue doing this just once a week while we have some good hot topics, and we'll continue sending out those invitations.
Awesome. Thanks, you guys.
Well, we're going to start the recording here, so I appreciate you guys joining.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And don't forget.